A very good afternoon to everyone. Thank you so much for joining us today for this webinar. It is very nice to have you all here on a pleasant Saturday morning. I'm Pratik Vodur, a third year law student from Symbiosis Law School, Pune. And on behalf of the Cyber Research and Innovation Society, I will be your host for this webinar. And before we get started, if you have any questions or any queries during the presentation, please type them out in the chat box. I can assure you that I will constantly keep checking the chat box, and I'll address it and I'll bring it up in the webinar. And today's topic is leveraging computer forensic in litigation. And we have five eminent speakers with us to talk about the various aspects of this topic. And this webinar is organized by the Cyber Research and Innovation Society. So a brief introduction about them before we move on to the topic. The Cyber Research and Innovation Society, also known as CRIS, was founded to build a digitally secure future for the society by collaboration between national and international leaders in government, industry, and academia, focused on cyber laws, cyber security, and cyber forensics. Our vision is to bring awareness, provide education, and conduct research and innovation in the cyber domain to help address emerging issues related to cyber law, cyber security, data, finance, and risk driven by existing and emerging technologies. So then that brings us to the present topic. So with the advent of digital age, cyber security has become a major issue. And the future is going to be digital. And thanks to COVID-19, the pace at which we were adopting digital means of doing things has become so many times faster. So and also let's take how we've started doing most of the things through electronic means. And naturally, this has also resulted in a tremendous increase in cyber crimes. And also, as we are doing more things through digital means, this also means that if there's any dispute in the future, that would also mean that the evidence would be in digital form. And that's the reason computer forensics would play a major part of litigation in the coming years, because traditional evidence would slowly start reducing and digital evidence would be increasing. And then without further ado, I would like to invite the first speaker. Our first speaker for the day would be Sri Bharat Rajagopalan J. A brief introduction about Bharat sir. He has been in the fraud detection and litigation support industry since 2002. Having handled more than 2,000 plus cases across multiple industries and geographies, Sri Rajagopalan brings in an extensive business understanding of various industry segments. His specific expertise includes interpreting the business and technical aspects to executable tasks, which then helps in mapping the gray areas and finding the black spots adopted in the fraud investigation. His specific expertise includes interpreting the business and technical aspects to executable tasks, which then helps in mapping the gray areas and finding the black spots adopted in fraud investigation. Sri Rajagopalan has broad understanding of multiple technologies, including Microsoft, open source, and newer technologies, including the cloud-based solutions and social media investigation. Sri Rajagopalan has testified in international and Indian courts on the methodology adopted in data aggregation from databases, other media sources, including servers, standalone PCs, and mobile devices. Sri Rajagopal has been associated in tax investigation cases on behalf of the income tax and sales tax department since 2011, and has supported in more than 200 plus cases in the last 5 years. He's also a certified electronic discovery specialist from Crawl On Track USA. He's also a member, Association of Litigation Support Professionals USA, High Tech Crime Investigators Association, USA, member of Association of International Arbitrators, London, and Association of Certified Financial Crime Specialists, USA. And he also assists agencies by conducting training as needed to introduce the best practices that are adopted globally on its fight on financial crimes. So Rajagopalan sir, if you can hear me, sir, are you ready? Do you want to go next, sir? Over to you, sir. So sorry to interrupt you, sir. You're muted. I think you need to unmute yourself, sir. I'll be there on the bottom left.
Yeah, am I audible to everyone?
Yes, sir. Yes. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you, Prateek. It is really nice to hear your introduction about me, and I'm really privileged to be part of this August gathering of professionals in the cyber and forensics field. It gives me immense pleasure to be part of this. Thanks to Neeraj sir for inviting and organizing this entire session. So I think we can move forward with the session. Just give me a moment. Let me share my screen. Is my screen visible to everyone? I believe the screen is now visible to all.
Yes, sir.
If there is any, if anybody is not able to see, kindly let me know so that accordingly adjustments can be made on the sharing. Now, before I go deep into the subject, I thought this would be the first session, being the first session, and we have some August speakers to follow up. I will just start with a very basic process as to what exactly is computer forensics and why is it required in terms of a litigation. In simple terms, all of us know what is a litigation since we all come with a legal and a technical background, but let's try to understand a little bit further in details as to what exactly happens. So when do a litigation happens? A litigation typically happens when there is a dispute between one or more parties and which requires the intervention of either a third party or a judicial forum to support us in terms of finding what is the right way to go forward or resolve the dispute. So now, whenever we talk about litigation, evidence becomes a part of the entire activity. So without evidence, your litigation is not going anywhere. So evidence can be either physical evidences or it could be electronic evidences. So as Prateek had mentioned in the call today, electronic evidence is becoming, or electronic data is now your life. Every moment of life, we are generating a footprint. Every minute, even this entire conversation, this training session is an electronic evidence in terms of some kind of a dispute if it arises in future. So, but what is the problem? So much of digital footprints. Is it easy to collect and provide everything as an evidence? No. So what exactly happens? Why is there a problem when we deal with electronic evidence? Two reasons. One, it is because it is transient. It is constantly changing and it is volatile. Now, coming down to electronic evidences, the process or the science that deals with the collection, preservation, analysis, presentation of the digital data in a court of law or any legal forum in a defensible manner can be attributed to the science of digital forensics. Now, instead of talking much of theory, which all of us know, let's quickly get into specific case studies where we have actually had electronic evidences or digital evidences which have played a very important role in defining the outcome of the litigation. The first case study which I want to address today would be that of a tax evasion case. I don't want to name the companies per se here, so I'm saying Company A. Company A has been reported for evading tax for a number of years by tax agencies. This is one of the most prominent cases that I have personally been involved into, where I testified in the court with regard to the findings that we made using the forensic techniques. So the company, a search and seizure operation was initiated by the tax agency and lot of evidence was collected, or lot of digital data was collected. To be frank, we collected little close to almost 40 to 50 terabytes of data was collected in this particular instance. And That is quite a huge amount of data when we are talking about in terms of what actually happens and how the company had over the years in a very planned and defined manner been evading tax. So now 40 to 50 terabytes of data is a lot of material, even in normal case, or even for anybody to look. So if we are looking at 50 terabytes of data, if you convert that into paper, possibly we are talking of something little close to about 2 to 3 crores of paper data for somebody to review, analyze, and then come back and report. Now, what were the evidences that were obtained in this particular case? Predominantly, the data that was obtained in this particular case were financial data, but we had also collected data relating to WhatsApp communications, normal short messaging service communications, voice notes, then CCTV footages, and a host of other data which were very divergent in nature. For instance, in this particular case, we also had to get some data from the social media sites such as Facebook and Instagram to cross-verify and compare them with the information that is provided by the directors of the company about some of their international travels. So essentially, when we are saying the kind of data that we are getting in any tax evasion case, or for that matter in any litigation or investigation, the volume of electronic data is now extremely high. Maybe not all the data that is collected is going to be relevant for the case, but it is left to the investigator and the defendant teams and the plaintiff teams to find out which data is evidence and which data is not evidence, or what data has the evidentiary value relating to the case and what data does not have. Now, the final important thread in this particular case related to an email trail which we had obtained from their Gmail servers, which very clearly talked about the daily transactions in terms of volume of sales, the kind of funding that was initiated by the company to reroute the excess money that they were getting from the sales to other business lines and to the personal assets creation of the organization and its directors. In fact, one of the email essentially talked about utilizing the service of a third-party professional consultant to siphon out money out of the country and procure assets to the tune of multiple crores, which was reported in their regular books of accounts as employee welfare expenses. So it is the digital forensic techniques here primarily adopted included normal data analytic techniques plus forensic methods of acquiring the various servers and other digital data sets, analyzing them using predefined review tools which facilitated the acquisition. One of the biggest advantages on this entire exercise was the timeline analysis that was done during the acquisition. So this actually helped us in understanding when and where and how the transaction, the movement of the individual, helped in direct relevance to the transfer of funds. So whenever the company's director was traveling abroad, there would be a fund transfer to his foreign account. Whenever the company's family is, whenever the managing director's family was going out on a tour, there would be an excess cash withdrawal from the company account to satisfy their requirements in terms of their pleasures. So forensic techniques in this particular case, plus a huge amount of data analytics, facilitated the entire process of finding out how funds were moved from one layer to another, and how it was very carefully moved out in such a way that from a normal pretext, without having all the data sets, it would have been impossible for any single analyst or single team to decipher the planned evasion. Now, this way of finding this case is currently challenged by the company in terms of the quantification that has been made in the court of law. Now, here are some of the problems that we faced when the issue was brought up. One of the major issues that the defending team from the company side said was that is the methods adopted during acquisition of the electronic data was not in sync with the common standard procedures. Second issue that they raised was that is lot of personal data when phones were imaged, when their social media accounts were tapped into for certain information. So they said a lot of personal information about the individuals have been collected by the department, which is not acceptable. Although many of the personal information that has been part of the forensic copies of data that has been acquired, the department had taken a stand that we will not review those set of data which is not relevant to the case, nor will they be retained after a certain period of time, and they will be deleted permanently. So now here are the problems that we will normally face in cases that are not of criminal nature, that are of primarily civil nature, and that which involves personally identifiable information. In fact, luckily for us in India, the data protection rules are still not completely in place. If we have to consider the scenarios of, say, Europe or US, the amount of data that is collected and the amount of personally identifiable information that is available will have to be redacted, which need not be the case in India at this point of time, but maybe in future we will have such kind of scenarios. Now, one of the common problems when it comes to defending digital data in court, as all of you know, is the transient nature of this data. Now, I have collected certain amount of data on day one. By the time the review gets completed, it becomes day 365. So the defending party can always claim that there were certain set of data which has been manipulated by the agency whoever is collected. Second common problem that we face is, unfortunately or fortunately, many of our law enforcement agencies do not have full-fledged dust-free rooms where digital data could be safely retained. Although there are storages available, but it is not fully dust-free, and there is always a possibility of the collected data getting corrupted. The collected data can accidentally be deleted. The collected data could actually get tampered with if the user is unaware of the process and procedures that are adopted. However, this being said, when a forensic copy is acquired, majority of the times multiple copies are retained so that the original data is always available to the team, which can be replicated even when required in the court to prove that the data sets that has been collected has not been tampered with. Similarly, we also have certain documentary procedures such as the chain of custody. And whenever we are presenting it to the court, the Form 65B and other documentary procedures which may help and facilitate in defending that the digital data sets that has been acquired and the methods adopted during the acquisition, review, analysis and interpretation of data, there has been no malpractice or there has been no tampering of original data sets is done. Any questions on this case study? Hello? Hello?
Yeah, hello, sir.
Ah.
Yes, sir. So we thought that we'll take questions at the end of your presentation. So
sure. So as far as this thing, so maybe we can plan for all the questions at after the session is complete.
Yes, sir.
So this is one of the prominent case studies where it required our team per se to defend our findings in the court in such a way that we were able to very clearly explain on the various facets in terms of both the forensic integrity of the data that was acquired and the relevant analysis that were used using both open source as well as proprietary tools and technologies to ensure that the findings which we have made is in sync with the standard operating procedures that is followed around the globe in terms of data acquisition, processing, analysis, review, and presentation. I'll share you with another case study where, which is, this is an ongoing case which I'm going to currently share with you. Pratik, I'm having some issues in the sharing.
Yes. Can you?
Yeah.
Are you? Can you click on? Yes, sir. Now I can find.
Yeah. Yes. Now, one of the other. This is an ongoing case which is involving two individuals. One has been accused of cyber and social media harassment. And the person who is been complained about has gone on to file a sexual harassment against the person who said that I'm being bullied. So this is actually a very interesting case in the sense both sides are accusing each other of some kind of a injustice done to them. While the person who has been accused claims that the person who has accused has caused a sexual harassment against him, the first person has gone on to say this person has been cyberbullying me. He has been posting bad things about me in various social media, especially
with relation to certain specified sites where I have been broadly and very badly affected. Just to dwell deep on this, in this scenario, Rita, the name is changed here. The person's name and phone number has been shared by the accused onto multiple web portals, including those that deal with call girls and online sex services. So an investigation based on the complaint by Rita has been initiated, and some of the interesting findings that we got was that is little close to about 56 sites in total dealing with various call girl services plus other personal services including massages and things like that had the phone numbers of Rita. For this instance is a national level sportsperson, and she has been of late, her analysis of the phone revealed that from the time the posting was initiated, she had been receiving random calls from people and random messages on her WhatsApp inviting for special services or special personal services. So this girl had gone on to make a complaint with the cyber team of the state police. The state police initiated an action and they came back saying that there is one individual who's doing this. But it was not possible during the initial investigation to drill down to who was the person. An inquiry was initiated and Rita was asked, do you have any people whom you suspect could be doing this? She came out with a list of 3-4 people. So they were all the targets were constantly monitored for their social media activities. Now, incidentally, parallelly, there was another initiative that was taken up to map to the IP address from where these various requests or where her profile and her phone numbers have been registered. So all these phone numbers and were registered from a single MAC address, but using multiple IP address, in the sense that a single device has been used from where a person has logged in and he has created different profiles of her and has constantly been posting about it. But an analysis of the social media activities of the suspected individuals resulted showed us that out of the list of 4 people she had mentioned, only 2 were relatively active in the social media. The other 2 were not even present in any of the social media except messaging applications. Now, this is a starting point for us. But we don't know who is posting, why they are posting, and how they are related or how they are connected with the affected party. Meanwhile, one of the persons whose name has been listed as a suspect went on to file a sexual harassment case against Rita, saying that this lady has been torturing me and wanting my specialist services for.
Yes, sir. Sorry to interrupt you, sir. Actually, like, we have a paucity of time and other speakers.
Okay, fine. I will just close it in about another. Give me 2-3 minutes. We'll close
it. Yes, sir. Sure. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. So, As of now, what we have found in this particular case is that is, we have been tracking down to the two targeted individuals who are active. At the same time, an incognito profile of one of the third person, especially the person who has filed for a sexual harassment case, was identified using the forensic techniques when we had an opportunity to review his phone. So what he had done is he has created an incognito profile, and using the incognito profile, he has been accessing the various social medias, which are say various social media as well as the advertising sites over the last few months. So now, as we speak in the current stage, the investigation stage, so we have some crucial evidences which we have obtained saying that this person could actually be the culprit, but there are also additional evidences which are being collected to ensure that our findings are intact. So now this is possible only because of the forensic techniques that are currently available when we analyze forensic social media per se. Social media investigations are becoming slightly complex when people use a incognito mode or when people go into Tor and other websites through which they are accessing the various social media activities. Okay, now I think I'm ready to take any questions if you have on these two case studies, or we can retain it for end of the session.
Yes, sir. Actually, yeah, we are planning to like keep all the questions to the end. So we'll definitely come back to it. Yes, sir.
Yeah,
thank you so much, sir.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
Yes, so our next speaker would be Mr. Santosh Katsare, sir. So Santosh Katsare, sir, he possesses several reputed qualifications such as CHFI, CEH, RHCHA, IVTA, Advanced Cyber Forensic Course, that is CDAC, Cyber Crime Investigator, ISO, IEC, and Access Data Certified Professional. He has 20 plus years plus rich experience in the field of information security, digital forensic, cyber laws, and incident response. He has trained numerous people in the DFIR field, and DFIR field. He has been a speaker in various international conferences, such as International Conference on Cyber Law, Cyber Crime, and Cyber Security. And also, he has authored various articles on information security and digital forensics in national and international publications. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. We can hear you well, sir.
Firstly, thanks for inviting me. I'll directly jump to my core subject, which has been given to me today. I have been asked to speak on the provenance of digital forensic report in the court of law. So it's more of a, you can say, report writing skills or communication skills, which are involved in this kind of a topic. To start with, let me tell you, accuracy, credibility, and legal scrutiny are the key features of any digital forensic report. Now, not everyone can actually acquire this skill set in a very short span of time. Writing a report requires a lot of experience, because outcome of any digital forensic laboratory is the report, and which is present in the court of law. And this is the same report which has to be justified or stood by the expert witness, the analyst, who is the author of this report. The ultimate audience of this report, if you see, is the judiciary, and hence the report should be seen such a way that the author should be able to put forth his findings and recommendations in a systematic and clear manner. The digital forensic report, which is prepared by the forensic laboratory, can be the most effective, if not the only way, to answer many questions about the incident which has taken place. Now, what you see, the digital forensic report is only a statement of fact of the case being investigated. You cannot come to any conclusions by the report. It can assist the investigation. Yes, it may be one of the most important aspect of the investigation, but it cannot come to any final conclusions because it may be one of the, you can say, aspects with the IO or the investigating officer has at his disposal. During the analysis, the digital forensic report can only find the modus operandi or create the sequence of digital, you can say, the incidents or events which have taken place. But you know, he cannot put man behind the machine. Putting the man behind the machine is the task of the investigating officer, not of a digital forensic analyst who's actually doing the case or analysis. Your report assess the investigating officer to come to conclusion and may not always be the only source of information. So that has to be kept in mind. So if you have to prove or stand by the report in the court of law, there are few things or few, you can say, features which should be a part or which you should keep in mind while making a report. First is the accuracy part. Fact is fact and nothing else. That should be kept in mind. If any doubtful evidence should not be a part of your report. The same evidence should be derived by different tools and by using the same procedures which you have used by different analysts. Second aspect is the clarity aspect. The report should be clear, leaving no ambiguity in the minds of the reader or concerned, whether it's an expert witness that maybe an external expert is called, prosecutors, or even the judiciary for that matter. One more important fact, and which I feel is more important, is the credibility. A credibility, how do you get credibility to a report? A report credibility can come in only, firstly, of course, the expert witness or the person or the lab who has actually done the analysis. Second is whether the lab is notified. For example, in India, we have 79A of the IT Act, which actually means you can become an examiner of electronic evidence if you are, if you qualify or if you are judged by the particular, you can say, set of schemas or processes which you have to adhere to. Credibility also come with license tool. Like if you have some license tools, which you can, I can say NIST approved tool, because NIST is one of the platform which also gives, you have a separate computer forensic tool testing program, which is there. If you select the tools which are being approved internationally, they are then acceptable and they bring credibility to your report. One more important aspect is the accountability. Now the digital forensic analyst who is actually endorsing the report is accountable and answerable for whatever he has mentioned in that report. So he should be very careful while actually writing or whatever he is mentioning in that report. Last, it's a very menial aspect, but is a simplicity. It should be easy to understand. You can't be technical in a report, or you can't just give technical jargons in the report, because you should know who the final reader is, whom you're trying to convince. So how can you make it simple? You can say some flow charts, some diagrams, some graphs. So it makes it more, you know, simple for a person to understand. Now, and the last part is legal scrutiny. See, it should be as per the laws, law of the land, like we have the IT Act in place. So it should stand the legal scrutiny. It should be produced to the court by relevant law enforcement agency who is doing the investigations. So legal scrutiny is very important. Now let me shift the topic. I've been given only 20 minutes, so I want to push in the core aspects, what I feel should be a part of the report. When you see a report, now what should be the different sections in the report? First is the brief of the case. Now what the brief of the case should contain? It should basically contain the documents or the inputs provided by the agency who has given you the report for analysis. For example, the FIR, mentioning of FIR, then it also have to have the chain of custody details, then it has to have other important parts, which is the brief of the case, means what that case is about. You as an investigator, analyst, you don't have to write the whole incident as such, but at least the referencing of that case should be the part of the brief of the case. Now, second part, which I feel is the details of digital assets which are received for analysis. This is an important part, because what happens is you received in some in packets, a packet may have 10 devices. So when you open that particular, firstly, whether you have checked the seal, whether you have matched the seals, the device which has opened, the serial number, all this should be part of this particular section of that report. That is the details of the report which is received. During the entire process, photography and videography is very important. So that also has to be mentioned as a part of the report, right? Now come to the analysis part. That is the next section after that, which I feel should be, means it's a mandatory part, of course. A digital forensic analysis is carried out as per the questionnaire provided by the IO. You cannot keep it open-ended. So the IO has to give you a questionnaire and you have to go as per the questionnaire. What is it? Otherwise, it is an unending case. It may take, if the case has to finish in 3 months, it may take another 6 months. In some cases, investigating officer just requires the extracted data. So you have to just give him the extracted data with some legal sanctity and a 65B legal sanctity. When I mean, when you do hashing, you maintain the integrity and give a 65B along with it. It is also recommended here, very strongly recommended, while you carry out hashing. This should be part of the report, by the way. You should do at least two types of hashing algorithm. It is MD5 or MD5 is the older one, but SHA can be the second. Why I've put in MD5 still? Because most of the commercial schools still give you MD5 hashing hashing techniques. The modus operandi should be mentioned in the report. And as I said, graphical, you can say flowcharts, figures can be part of the report. To make it more acceptable to the court of law, it would be a very great idea if you can mention at the end of the report, FAQs, frequently asked questions. Why am I saying this? Because whenever I've gone to the court, they start with basics, what is the evidence, what is hashing, what is done. So it's better, it's a very good to mention, have a FAQ, which makes it easier for that, you can say the judiciary to understand the basics before he starts questioning you as an expert. So it reduces time, the understanding is also better. Now coming on to, terminologies, you should be very careful by using terminology, like you should use words like sound forensic techniques, global standards, law of the land. Although they sound very flashy, but these are very important because it actually brings or conveys a lot of meaning to your report. If a digital forensic laboratory is notified, for example, under 79A, of the IT Act, it should be mentioned and it should be part of the report because it brings in, as I said, more credibility of the report. It also should be noted that at all times, confidentiality and integrity of the analysis carried out is maintained at the lab, and that should actually be come out in that report. Now coming into one more aspect of the forensic tools. Firstly, let me tell you, you should not use one tool to derive the evidence. At least minimum two tools should be used to derive the same evidence, so that you yourself are sure that this evidence can be retrieved by any tool using the same process. So, and in this, the most important factor is mentioning the name of the tool and the version number of the tool, because even the versions of the tool differ sometimes may not help out the other examiner. So if you mention this is the version of the tool, because the features of every version changes. So the tool should be mentioned and the process should be mentioned. Now, once coming on to the recommendations and conclusion, I've already said you have to mention the statement of fact and not come to any conclusion. You can mention the modus operandi, you can mention how this particular happened, but you can't say who did it, and you can't conclude that a person is a culprit or not a culprit. There are a few points which should be kept of the report. The report is always classified. It should have some classification. Should always form, should be from a notified lab, should go for a notified lab. Of course, there's no harm. I mean, there's no bar in having from other labs also, but after the approval of the court. Then should mention the forensic tool. Should be stamped, signed, every page should be stamped and signed, and should be accompanied with a 65B. There are a few minor aspects which people forget about the report. There should be a distribution list. There should be disclaimers. Your report should have disclaimers, like a disclaimer that, okay, what all is required, that this report, no one is able to reproduce the report, or this report is done by so-and-so method. The report should have classification. Now, the one more important part is the annexures which you put. Annexures, as I said, there should be an annexure of photography, videography. If there's a specific questionnaire, there can be an annexure of those particular questions be answered. There can be a connection of tools being used, as I said, FAQs, the 65B, if it can be an annexure, there can be there's something else which you would like to add additional information. Now, preservation of the report is also very important. The digital copy has to be, even if you give a hard copy, a digital copy has to be mentioned, be kept in the lab. Now, I'll not go into much because I'm running out of time. I've been less time, but let me tell you, expert witness, the expert is a skillful and a subject matter expert. Now, usually people who sign the reports are subject matter expert because they have a plethora of experience, say more than around 10 years, and they have done a lot of, but the prerogative of allowing a person to depose as an expert witness is of the court. Court may allow you or may not allow you depending on if they feel it so. So not everyone can depose as expert witness, that should be kept in mind. And a third party expert witness also may be called if required. Now regarding, I'll just say a few things about brief. I told you there should be a FAQ key, what you should give to the inner report if possible, because now in my case, when there are a lot of pendencies in, especially the forensic lab, state lab, you can't go into that. But if you are an independent investigator, or if you have a questionnaire already made FAQs, like who prepared the report, what is the qualification of the digital forensic expert? Well, then is there anyone else who has assisted you in this analysis? Was it prepared, means the questions which usually court asks, was it prepared under any influence or pressure of external person? Have you maintained confidentiality of the report? Was your lab notified? Then are there signatures on a report of yours? Do you stand by a report? What are the differences between digital and cyber forensics? What is hashing? What is the licensing of the tools? So these are series of questions which can be form a part of the questionnaire. Now coming to the end, digital forensic report is important for overall criminal investigation, but sometimes prove the most crucial, you can say nail evidence in the for nailing the accused. However, it is not the only evidence, as I've said, and it may sometimes the court may not take it into cognizance also. Depending. So while preparing a report, the communication skill set is very important, which comes into play, because communication skill set of the person who is writing the report, and the same has to, when he goes to the court and deposes in the form of, you can say, as an expert witness, because it has to stand the legal scrutiny. Now, one or two more short points I'll make here. What I want to say, how you prove, provens, one is the report, which is supported. Second is the chain of custody, whether it's properly maintained. Now, someone asked me sometimes, most of the time, what about the SOPs of what is being done in the lab? Do you have SOPs? Now see, if your lab is notified by default, all the SOPs procedures have been checked by the notifying agency, and it is checked yearly on a yearly basis if there's any divergence from that fact. So if you have a notified lab, you don't have to worry about all the other things. And in addition to that, only what you have to give the 65 be the legal sanctity to that particular report. So if you have to prove a report, firstly, a person, if you have to prove a report in the court of law, you should be totally confident what you're writing. You should go as per the law, use forensic sound techniques. And last but not this, there should be a lot of, I've mentioned few things like clarity, simplicity, legal sanctity, all should be there. So this is what I wanted to say on especially proving your report in the court of law. I hope I have able to convey some important aspect which people were not aware, or even if they were aware, they must have learned something from what I was saying. Thanks a lot. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. It really was very insightful. Whatever you spoke, it gave us a very good idea about the ground realities, how things function. So, and we'll entertain the questions at the end after all the speakers done. We will then move on to your questions, sir. So for now, we'll move to the next speaker. The next speaker would be Sri Venkatesh Murthy, sir. And sir, I'll make you the host after I'm done with your introduction, sir. So Venkatesh Murthy, sir, has over 15 years experience in cybercrime investigation training and digital forensics. He is also currently managing a program for capacity building of law enforcement officials by training through the Digital Forensics Initiative of DSCI. And also, he is also the director of Data Security Council of India. He was also deeply involved in the setting up of the country's unique public-private partnership initiative, Cybercrime Investigation Training and Research, CCITR, that's the abbreviation. It was done at the Cybercrime Police Station, CID headquarters, Bengaluru, in partnership with the Karnataka Police, Infosys Foundation, and DSCI. Mr. Murthy has also conducted exclusive cybercrime training programs for police, prosecution, and judiciary of India. He has edited several publications for law enforcement, including the Cybercrime Investigation Manual, Pocket Guide for Investigators, and many more. He's also an alumnus of IBLP program of US Department of State on the topic Linking Digital Policy to Cybercrime Law Enforcement in February 2017. He also holds a Bachelor's of Engineering degree in Telecommunications from Visveshwaraya Technological University, Karnataka. So, sir, I'll make you the host now. After you are done with your presentation, you can make me the host again. So, can you hear me, sir?
Yeah, Pratik, I'm able to hear you.
Yes, sir.
Hope my screen is visible. Hope the screen is visible, Pratik. Pratik, you are able to hear me? Pratik, you are able to hear me? I think you are on mute. Okay. Yeah. Okay, good afternoon all. At the outset, I would like to thank Chris, Mr. Neeraj Arora for having me here to interact and share my little experience on the theme of this webinar. I'm asked to discuss primarily on the forensic examiner's dependency on various tools. Let me tell you, it's not an easy task for a digital forensic practitioner to work on the emerging advanced storage devices, including the latest smartphones, the IoT devices, and many more. Unlike the old age personal computers that had standard interfaces and protocols to communicate directly with the storage media, if you remember those days, the IDE hard drives, in fact, I used to end up the presentation with a saying, with the last slide, if your drive won't spin, your case won't win. But now with the latest SSD hard drives, so there is no concept of any mechanical motion or movable parts at all. Okay, so there is no such standard for the latest devices. So the in fact, the latest digital devices manufacturers, that includes the IoT devices, the mobile phone, the smartphones, or CCTV manufacturers. So what they are doing is they are creating their own proprietary non-documented protocols that makes the life of a digital forensic practitioner very difficult. This problem of non-standardized environment has mandated the forensic research community to reverse engineer each device. Every time a new operating system is released, say for example, any mobile phone, so then the forensic research community will have to do a reverse engineering, and then they will have to come with some data extraction methods. So in my view, yes, we are dependent on tools for performing a digital forensic examination, but the degree of dependency of tools, it depends on the forensic examiner himself, how much aware he is. So based on that, his dependency will be decided. So in today's 15-20 minutes slot, let me first start my timer. I've kept it for 18 minutes now. So since it is 20 minutes, I have already eaten 2 minutes. So I've kept timer for 18 minutes. So I will try to close it exactly at after 18 minutes. So digital forensics, I would like to discuss something which is very emerging, which is not discussed so much. So digital forensics and privacy. While the forensic examiners across all the areas, like let it be law enforcement, let it be the service providers, while we're still struggling very hard to get the sense of digital forensics utilization to full extent, privacy is also now widely discussed. Thanks to Edward Snowden, this gentleman, when he made some of the classified documents public, so people become more aware about their privacy, because we always believe that privacy is bodily privacy. But this gentleman, when he released those classified documents about the mass surveillance activities of a government, so people started worrying about privacy. And as a result, there were a lot of suggestions to preserve privacy while being online. So as a result, full disk encryption usage raised. I was not aware about the already existing BitLocker encryption in Windows operating system, even though I started using Windows since Windows 3.1, Windows 95, Windows 97. So post Vista, Microsoft Vista onwards, this BitLocker was available, but still I was not aware. But the moment this gentleman released all those classified documents, we started worrying about our privacy. So security deletion, we used to see criminals satisfied after committing any crime. We used to simply delete the file, we used to go to a recycle bin and empty it. But now he's also now advanced. He uses some secure deletion program to remove the traces. So customer to select the server location, select a country which is where there is no diplomatic relationship, okay? So digital forensics and privacy is a reasonable expectation of privacy. Data that may not be relevant to the case may be perused during investigation. Focused queries while analyzing the digital media. So these are two expectations from a privacy point of view, okay? So privacy enhancing framework, basically what they intend to do, should not perform significant number of additional tasks that would invade the privacy of the user of that particular computer or mobile phone. Limit data related to parties who are not under investigation. Okay. Record any accidental or intentional access of private information. So these are some of the expectations, but the real problem lies here. Can codes give warrant to inspect only a certain portion of the hard drive? Like since it is a cheating case, 419 IPC case, so please investigate or please examine only all those documents which are financial in nature, like tally or your Excel, Access, all those things. Can such order be given? Question mark. I don't think so. Even if the investigator knows specific information about the file, even the digital forensic examiner knows what to extract, but he doesn't know where that data is actually residing, because it might be encrypted, a folder encryption might be there, it might be mislabeled, somebody might have kept it in some other other folder, or he might have tried to change the signature also, file signature, which can be detected only by using certain forensic tools, whether it is a particular file signature or not, stored in some hidden directories and unallocated sectors. So if the file itself is deleted, it's not part of C drive or D drive or E drive, so it is unallocated. So this is the real issue the forensic examiners they are facing, because we are done with the golden age of digital forensics. Gone are those days, 10-15 years before, where the digital forensics was seen as a magic window, where we used to get that past and present, like we see in the mythological movies, where the past or future could be predicted. So forensic, actually it escaped from the lab because of the CSI effect also. I'm not sure about how much we are affected in India, but there is something called a CSI effect, the CSI Miami, CSI New York. These are some of the television TV series, which relied heavily on technology for the court, the same. Okay, so the CSA effect altered the courtrooms also. Both advantages and disadvantages are there. Advantages are that the jury members have become more aware about the usage of technology for commission of crime, and also they are in a position to appreciate how the law enforcement is using the same technology for detection of crime. While criminals are using for commission, law enforcement is using it for detection. Okay, so there are good and bad both, and of course there are some situation where there is unreasonable expectation that even though the other evidence is produced, why the digital evidence is not produced. So such things also exist. So now in terms of tools or the procedures, what is this forensically sound procedure? Because whenever you want to master any subject, two things are very important. One is what to expect, what not to expect. I mean, expectations and limitations. What are the expectations of this forensics and what are its limitations? So live acquisition of a hard drive, the computer is in on condition and you want to acquire the logical portion. Okay, so there would be changes because by the time the acquisition is completed, there might be some changes in the hard drive. Some files, metadata might get changed. Some files may get created. Okay. And when it comes to mobile phone, is there any forensically sound procedure to gather evidences from smartphones? I'm not sure. 2% does acquisition of same mobile phone, both acquisition will never match because the mobile phone, you cannot write block a mobile phone. Precisely, in simple words, it is not possible to write block a mobile phone. And also evidence dynamics and introduction of errors. This is something very, very, very important when it comes to whenever you are using forensics for your litigation. Say, for example, you want to image a hard drive and you are using some tool like a DD command, people who are well-versed with Linux. So Linux has this excellent DD command, which can be used to create an exact replica of the seized exhibit or the seized hard drive. Now, what if whenever you are using this DD command, say for example, DDIF is equal to STA, okay, and OF, that is output file, is equal to SDB. What if the investigator is a human being? What if he replaces SDA with SDB? The two artist destination, the source and destination are interchanged. So then there's a big problem. And also you need to understand the human nature. We are prone to such committing such mistakes. So if you read 3:13 a.m. as 3:30 p.m, you will be implicating a wrong individual. So these are some of the limitations when it comes to using technology. And we do often hear about this artificial intelligence and digital forensics because I am unable to find a place where AI has not crept in. Okay, everywhere artificial intelligence is discussed. So in my view, definitely artificial intelligence can help the investigator in automating certain processes. It might be because those days we used to struggle very hard when it comes to finding one or two obscene images. It was like finding a needle in a haystack. Okay, it was like that. But today, thanks to certain advanced tools, which identifies the media files from millions of files, and also it can further filter in identifying the photographs where the skin exposure or the skin tone percentage can be defined. So artificial intelligence should be used as an investigative aid, not as an investigator. I don't think it can immediately, in the current condition, it can replace an investigator. That's my personal view. I may be wrong. Okay. So when it comes to digital forensics as a whole, starting from the processes that one should follow in acquisition, because the tools comes later. Because the digital forensic practitioner who sits in the lab, he may not be able to visit the place for collection of digital evidence, because collection of digital evidence in criminal cases may be done by the police, and later after obtaining the court permission, the seized exhibit is sent to forensics and laboratory for seeking opinion. So here I would like to present a couple of ISO standards, which would definitely help us to not reinvent the wheel. I'm not endorsing any standard, but since something already exists, instead of reinventing the wheel, why don't we use it as a foundation and whatever changes that needs to be done can be made. So 27037 provides you the guidelines for identification, collection, acquisition, and preservation of digital evidence. Once the platform is now ready, I think then you can move on to the other methods like the ISO 27042, which speaks about guidelines for analysis and interpretation of digital evidence, and similarly the other standards also. So using these standards as a basic premise to define your own this thing would be really good. And when it comes to tools, see, we are in a confused state because there exists large number of digital forensic products in the market, indigenous, commercial, free, open source. How do we select? How do we select a tool for that would satisfy our requirements? Is there any validation of tools? Okay. So NIST, from a global perspective, National Institute of Standards and Technology, so they have launched this something very unique. There is a project called CFTT project, Computer Forensic Tool Testing Project. So where the testing and validation of digital forensic tools is done to help the tool manufacturers as well as users. So they also publish this, the results also are published online. So you can simply visit their website and you would be able to get further information. Because what they've done is they have used certain standard testing methods that would include ISO 17025 and 5725. Based on that, they have done some analysis. Okay. So now the question here is forensic examiner forensic examiner must use proprietary tools for examination of digital evidence. Is it correct? Whether the statement is correct? So in my view, demanding proprietary software for examination should be seen as a direct violation of essential criteria for acceptance of scientific evidence. Okay. Because you cannot endorse or you cannot recommend. There is, to the best of my knowledge, at least in India, there is no tool called as court validated tool. With my limited knowledge, when I say best of knowledge, I admit that it's limited knowledge. Okay. So what I believe is two things are very important: reproducibility and repeatability. So reproducibility is one criteria which talks about delivering same results with same tool when you try to reproduce it. The second one is you get the same results with the two different tools. Okay. So when the tool is able to pass this criteria for acceptance, I think it should be admitted. So second thing is about the capturing the volatile memory, because we still have that confusion whether to acquire RAM content or not. We often do this pulling the plug, but here the tools play a very important role, because I am again talking about our dependency on the tool. Because those days we used to simply, if the computer is in on condition, we were taught that some booby trap might be there. Don't go for a normal shutdown. You pull the plug from the wall. All these things we heard a lot. But now with the latest, the RAM size, I used to use a 8 MB RAM computer. Okay, 8 MB and 64 MB RAM user was seen as a rich person those days. But today a normal computer would be having a 4 GB of RAM and it runs to 100 GB also, we have seen more than 100 GB also. So examiners, what they need to perform live capture of memory prior to obtaining a digital disk image to capture possible keys. Because this encryption, if it is BitLocker encrypted, so irrespective of whether it is relevant or not, the standard operating procedure itself has now become very dynamic. So it has undergone certain changes where the investigators are asked, or the whoever is called as the first responder, who goes for the incident response, who goes for the collection of digital evidence, he should not neglect or ignore the RAM. And there is another myth that the volatile data present in RAM is gone upon system shutdown. Because why we are worried about RAM? Why we are worried about the computer which is in off which is in non condition when it is switched on? The volatile memory, that is the memory which is residing in the RAM, is flushed out or drained out. But certain forensic tools would be able to perform some analysis based on certain files available in the operating system, like iberfield.sys, crashdump files, and also page file and swap file. So these are some of the files which reside in the Windows operating system, which can be collected by the forensic examiner, and when subjected to an appropriate tool, you would be able to get those information which were supposed to be in the RAM. Okay. So now advancement in mobile forensics, I have another 1 minute, 54 seconds. So usage of tools. So this is something called as a pyramid. Okay. It is a pyramid of pain for us. Okay. So bottom, less technical, the duration is very less. Okay. Less invasive. Whereas as you climb the ladder, okay, as you try to reach the tip of the pyramid, it becomes more technical. The analysis time increases like anything, and you need additional skill sets to handle, and it is more invasive. Okay, manual extraction is those days when we were using those Nokia handsets, which did not support any sort of connecting cables. I myself have seen investigators calling the studio guy with a camera. He used to take the photograph of the evidence, like some obscene SMS was there. He used to simply take a photograph and he used to give it to the investigator. So can I extend by two more minutes, please? So the second one is the logical analysis, where the partition information is to be recovered. And then came the JTAG or XDump, where the agent was introduced into the smartphone to recover the data. And chip-off is an invasive process in the sense you need to tear down the mobile handset to identify the memory chip. And if it is not encrypted, you will be in a position to recover evidence from the chip. And microraid, to the best of my knowledge, I have not seen anywhere, whether it is in India or outside India, the microraid tool usage. So I think I would like to end here. So my timer has also started beeping. So I'm closing now. Pratik, I will again make you as a, how do I make it? Make host. Yeah, Pratik, now you are the host.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much, sir. It was definitely a very, very informative presentation that you had. With respect to the questions, we'll come back to it after all the speakers are done, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. And next, we'll have Advocate Neeraj Arora, sir, who will be taking over from here. Mr. Neeraj Arora, sir, is a practicing advocate, an arbitrator, and a computer forensic expert. He is an advocate on record in the Supreme Court and special public prosecutor with the National Investigation Agency, and also on the panel of controller of certifying authorities, Ministry of Information Technologies, Government of India. Mr. Neeraj Arora, also being a technocrat, has developed a strong dominion over cyber law and finance domains, and has a unique ability to integrate bit and byte, debit and credit with law. His exposure as defense lawyer, special public prosecutor, law enforcement officer, and arbitrator give him an edge to appraise any case from all the perspectives. He's a law graduate from Delhi University, a fellow member of ICAI, and a certified fraud examiner from ACFE, USA. He has done a PG diploma in ADR, cyber law, and drafting of legislation, treaties, international agreements, and contracts from the Indian Law Institute, New Delhi. In the technology domain, he has done PGD, CEH, CHFI, CISA, CISSP, CCSK, and MBA in IT. Apart from various other certifications on emerging technologies, he's also a certified forensic computer expert and from IACIS, a certification duly approved by the Forensic Specialties Board. He's also an international coach on computer forensic with the International Association of Computer Investigative Specialists. He's also an arbitrator and a member of appellate tribunals at national and international level. He has successfully handled more than 600 matters in mediation and given 300 awards as an arbitrator and member of appellate arbitral tribunal and presided as presiding arbitrator in more than 50 cases. He's also the arbitrator on the panel of Delhi High Court Arbitration Center, NSC, MCX, Metropolitan Exchange, NCDEX, ICA, ICADR, CIAC, and many more. And also international arbitrator with the World Intellectual Property Organization, ADNDRC from Hong Kong, LCIA in UK, and KLRCM. He's also the managing partner of his techno-legal firm, Hazen Legal Associates. So without any further ado, over to you, Neeraj sir. I'll try to make you as the co-host first. So there's no option. I can't find the option of making you the co-host. So I'll make you the host. So after you're done, so you can make me the host again, sir.
Thank you, Pratik. First of all, being the president of the Cyber Research and Innovation Society, I welcome all the participants who have spent the time to be part of this webinar. Then I'm grateful to all the speakers who have spared their time and have shared their valuable thoughts on this challenging issue of the computer forensic. I'm handling these matters in routine in court, and I find there a very huge gap when the forensic experts are coming to the court. No doubt they are highly qualified, but you see, when we talk about the forensic, it is the court who is the ultimate driver. It is the court who has to decide about the admissibility and authenticity of the electronic evidence. So the real test for a forensic examiner is in the court, when court agree with his finding. So with this background, I'm going to discuss about the challenges which an expert faces in the court. I have shared my PPT. I think it is visible. So to just start with, to give a little bit background, though Mr. Santosh has spoken on this issue, and he has shared a very valuable information with all of you. So when an expert go to the court, expert need to be very clear about expert opinion and expert evidence. So first, coming to what is the expert evidence. Like any other evidence, it is the evidence which is perceived by the senses of the human being. And this evidence is categorized into two parts. One is the data evidence, second is the opinion evidence. Data evidence is the factual evidence, and the opinion evidence is of the advisory nature. It is upon the court whether to agree with or not to agree with. So the basic thing which we need to keep in mind is that the decision making, on arriving at a conclusion or judgment, is the power of the court when there is any litigation. So when any material come to the expert for the opinion, it is only for the advisory nature. It is only to assist the court. It is never a binding one. So court always look upon the forensic opinion like any other evidence. It has to be corroborated. It has to be supported by the relevant expert testimony. So now first, coming to who is the expert. Though the definition of the expert is nowhere, but I am explaining it from the various judgment given by our High Court and the Supreme Court. So the simple definition of the expert is the person, number one, who is having the educational background in a field. And that field should be the field with which the forensic opinion is concerned. Second is the practical knowledge in the field. How many cases he has done? What is his practical exposure? Whether he's in a position to differentiate between the what is correct or not correct based on his own experience, apart from the education knowledge. Third is his ability to carry the analysis and connecting it with the results. and after that connecting the reason with the final conclusion. So there are four things. Number one is the fact, second is the analysis, third is the reason, last is the opinion. And all the four have to be mapped and explained it to the court. And apart from that, if he has used any technology, then he has to explain the concept, principle about that particular technology. So that is the qualification of the expert in terms of the Indian law. So these are, I have referred two important judgments of the Supreme Court. So one is the Siddharth versus State of Delhi, where the court has stated that expert is only an expert if he follows the well accepted guidelines to arrive at a conclusion and support the same with the logical reasoning. So the very important thing is the reasons have to be supported with the opinion on one side and also with the analysis and the fact on the another side. Second judgment we have, where the court has stated that in order to bring the evidence of a witness as that of an expert, it has to be shown that he has made a special study of the subject or has acquired a special experience therein. Now coming to the competence. So competency is always derived from the education. So the same parameters are there for the competency. So first is the qualification, second is the competency. So I refer to the two very speaking judgment of our High Court, where the court has referred what do you mean by the competency of the expert. Now coming to the credibility. How you will ascertain the credibility of the expert? So again, here as I have discussed in the beginning, that we have the four components of any forensic process. Number one is the fact, second is the analysis, third is the reason, fourth is the conclusion or the final opinion. So how beautifully an expert can connect all these four and convince the court in appreciation of the evidence, so that is the credibility of the expert. So again, if we go by this concept, this judgment, again, everything would arise, emanate from his own knowledge into that particular field, his experience, his qualification, and his ability to explain the expertise. So as Mr. Santosh has also stated, that everything has to be explained in such a manner so that a prudent person could understand it. So how an expert is able to convince, that is very important. Then we have the admissibility of the forensic report. It is not a blanket thing that you file in the court and it would be admissible. No, court is going to analyze the various parameters. So first parameter is that the expert must be from the recognized field of expertise, particularly relating to the forensic. Evidence must be based on the reliable principle. So here, there are two components which the court will see. Number one is the admissibility of the evidence. So when we talk about the fact should also be admissible. So again, I would share here, like now there is a requirement of certificate under 665P. For example, a DVD has been received by an expert, which is without 65B, it is not admissible. So once if factual evidence is not admissible, the opinion would also not be admissible. So here the expert also need to make sure that the evidence on which he is working is admissible. Then whatever technique he is using, that should be admissible. That should comply with the Daubert principle. Expert should be qualified into that particular discipline. And the thing which is very important is, which I have seen in number of cases of forensic audit, not the computer forensic. So in case of forensic audit, various chartered accountant has come with their finding on that accounting forensic. But the court has stated that this is some material which is of very simple nature, from which the court can make opinion itself. So the basic line for the admissibility of the expert opinion is that whether the court require any assistance or not. And here the test is if the court can look upon the material and can make its own mind based on that material, then the requirement of expert is not there. Then court may refuse to admit the expert evidence. So now this is a very interesting case. This is one of the cases of the CBI where I was doing the cross-examination. And cross-examination was relating to the video file. And we have analyze what is the encoding date and time. When now encoding date and time is a very useful information, because the moment you prepare any video, so the when the video is saved, so that is encoding. And that encoding date and time tells you the when actually this video have been created, with which you can verify the date and time of that particular video. And in fact, indirectly, it also refers to the authenticity of that particular video. So in our case, as per the FIR, that witness has stated that video was created on 28th February. But the metadata of the video, which we retrieved using the EXIF data tool, it shows that the encoding date is the 5th March. So there is a gap of 7 days. And that gap has to be explained. Otherwise, the inference can be drawn that it has been tampered. Because the burden which is on the defense is to show the possibility of tampering and not the tampering. And interesting part is, when we ask the question from the expert who has given the opinion on video forensic, so my question was, can you tell as to what is the meaning of encoding in case of video file? His answer was no. Can we term such an expert as a forensic expert? See, encoding is something which is very basic. Encoding is conclusive evidence of tampering if the encoding is different, though it is not vice versa, because now there are certain tools by which we can even change the encoding metadata. But the very important thing is, which I think very few people know, and which is also one of the legal requirements, that encoding data is also part of the metadata mentioned in the section 7 of the IT Act. So it is mandatory to keep that data by any entity who is maintaining the data in the electronic form. So because it is an essential required for the admissibility of the retained data, so the metadata becomes one of the very important component of the electronic evidence, and same need to be exhibited in every case where we are handling with the electronic data. Though in some cases it may be done by the police, or in some cases it may be done by the forensic expert. Now this is another case, and a very interesting case, where an expert has given the opinion and court ultimately finds that the expert is not competent. So this case is of CCTV forensic, and the qualification of the expert when we did the cross-examination is the BTech and CHFI. So he does not have any specific qualification in forensic. Number two, he has no training in the CCTV. He has no qualification in the CCTV forensic. So this is all part of the cross-examination done by him. And then the interesting part is that he does not follow the basic principle of the computer forensic. For example, when he has received the original hard disk, he has not computed the hash value. He has not prepared the mirror image. He has done the forensic on the original hard disk. And when the court has directed him to prepare the mirror image of that hard disk, so it was the hard disk of 4 TB, what he did, he prepared a forensic, mirror copy using the write blocker with 32-bit addressing. And ultimate result was that it only captured 1.6 TB data, because it cannot capture more than that. Then no base hash value of the source or destination media was computed at all. So when the expert does not have the qualification in that specific field of which he is giving the opinion, and also he is not complying with the principle of the computer forensic, then it may be very difficult for the court to term such an expert to be a competent one. So this is another case which I just want to share with you to tell you what is the challenge for the forensic expert when he is doing the examination. And one of the biggest challenge comes from the possibility of tampering. So here one thing which we need to keep in mind is, when a particular person is proving the electronic evidence or a forensic report in the court, now I'm talking about the proving, then there are two requirements. One is the admissibility, second is the authenticity. So regarding authenticity, Mr. Santosh has explained in quite detail, but when a person is coming from the opposite side to rebut the authenticity, the burden on him in criminal cases is possibility of tampering. So only he has to show that this evidence could have been tampered. He is under no obligation to prove that it has actually been tampered. So now this is one of the cases from the Supreme Court, and the case was of murder. And during investigation, police find the fingerprint on a brass jug in the house of the deceased. They sent it to the lab after 4 days. Next day, accused was arrested, his fingerprint was taken, and these fingerprints were sent to the lab after 1 month. Fingerprints were not clear, hence they were taken twice again. Only because of this lapse in the time, this frequency of taking the opinion, the Supreme Court say that possibility of tampering cannot be ruled out. And also one of the another reason was that fingerprints were not taken as per the order of the magistrate, and only on this ground the accused was acquitted. So even as stated by Mr. Santosh also, that establishing the chain of custody is very important. You may have given one of the best opinion. It may connect the fact analysis, reason and the opinion, but if chain of custody is not proper, that may be sufficient for the court to draw the inference that it has been tampered or it cannot be relied upon. So forensic expert need to keep in mind the burden of proof which is on the prosecution and burden of proof which is on the defense. And accordingly, whether he is giving the opinion for prosecution or defense, he can take the extra care to prove his case before the court of law. Now coming to the SOP. So recently I have seen in a number of cases, even number of government forensic lab, they are not maintaining the proper SOP. But SOP is some of the very essential component that need to be followed. So there are a number of judgment to that regard that we will discuss in the forthcoming slide. But if there is no SOP, or if the SOP is improper, that may give rise to the cognitive bias. Because the approach which need to be adopted for the forensic is need to be an independent one. Forensic expert has to give the opinion which is objective one, which is the truth one. Now, his duty is not to support the prosecution case or the defense case. His duty is to give the opinion to the court so that the court can conclude about that particular case. So if there is no SOP, it means lack of objectivity, lack of credibility, lack of reliability. So that means even the analysis of a forensic expert is proper, will it? But still court may not rely upon it. Because the reason is, whenever any SOP is created, so SOP is created with an independent approach, with a concept of objectivity, that the opinion which should be there based on the similarities as well as the dissimilarities. So it should not only take into the account the case of the prosecution, or but also what is the possibility that this may not have been done by the other party, which I have felt that is lacking in large number of cases. So if there is no SOP, or SOP is improper, or SOP is not followed, so then it lacks the quality assurance, and ultimately court may not rely upon it. So now you see, this is one of the cases where we did the cross examination, and interesting part here is, if you look upon the first image at the top, so this is one of the video which is being relied upon by the prosecution, and interesting part is, within the video you can see this cursor, this URL bar. So it clearly shows that it is not a original video, but it is a re-recorded video. Again, when we retrieve the this particular image frame of the video, we find that the border is unequal. And unequal border only comes when it is a re-recording, because then you adjust the screen for the purpose of record. But the interesting part was that there were 11 video in that particular DVD, and in one video, the expert has given the opinion that it is a manipulated one based on the cursor, but remaining 10 video which have the same metadata, same frame, he has given the authenticity of the video. So see, basically what I want to convey here is that the approach of the forensic expert should be the objective one, should be the independent one, not to support the case of any party, but to support the cause of the justice and to help the court. Then coming to the validity of the scientific technology. So every technology which is being used by the forensic expert need to comply with the Daubert principle. So now we have so many judgments from our Supreme Court as well as the High Court that 65 that the compliance to Daubert principle is mandatory. So it laid down the four tests, and that is the reason why we need to use only the tools which are proprietary in nature. So that is the reason if we are using the open source tool, it may not be possible to comply with the Daubert principle. And the interesting part is that under the Daubert principle, the court is the gatekeeper. So a forensic expert who is giving the testimony can explain the ground for compliance of the Daubert principle, but ultimately it is the court who has to evaluate and to decide whether the technique which is used by the forensic expert comply with Daubert principle or not. So this is one of the very beautiful judgment, and I think this issue, if we analyze the various evidences using the different tool, we also find such challenges. So this is the case of murder, and during the murder, chloroform was used. So police, in order to investigate the source of chloroform, they analyzed the computer of the accused. And when they analyzed the computer of the accused, they find that the accused have accessed the chloroform, the word chloroform. Sorry, he has searched on the internet 84 times. So they use it as a corroborative evidence to establish the guilt of the accused. But during the trial, when the defense has used another tool, it shows that chloroform was accessed only 3 times. There are 2 different tools doing the same examination with a different result. The court asked the expert, prosecution expert, to explain the reason why one tool shows 84 times and another tool shows 3 times. Expert was not able to give a proper reply, and the court held that it does not comply with the Daubert principle. Such technology cannot be relied upon. And again, the other principle of the forensic expert that have earlier been mentioned by the speaker about the repeatability and reproducibility, that would also would not be complied in this case. And such a result cannot be relied upon. So when an expert is giving an opinion, he must keep in mind what could be the challenges, which could be coming from the opposite side. So it's always better that if you are giving some result, then you can verify it with more than one tool. Now coming to the another thing which I have observed in so many cases is that when the forensic report is being forwarded by the prosecution and also by our forensic lab, they are simply giving the reports. They are not attaching the test report. That is mandatory, because as earlier I have told you that it is a report which is of advisory nature. So court has to be convinced. So when the expert says that I have used the FTK, I have used the NKS, all these tools create their own report, which can be generated from these tool itself. So that means once an expert is saying that I'm going to rely upon this thing and relying upon this particular test, then he must generate the report of that particular tool and should annex with the report. If there is no report of the tool, then it has no evidentiary value. Then coming to the one of the very crucial thing regarding the interpretation. So now the one of the very important thing is the expert has to provide the reason to support his opinion, but at the same time, while giving the reason, he has to explain the similarity and dissimilarities, both the things. So what goes in favor of the test and what goes against the test? What is the possibility that this particular thing has been done by the accused, and what is the possibility it could not have been done by the accused? So the approach should only not be to establish an hypothesis, but also to rule out the hypothesis of the opposite party, and that's the best way. Because if the report covered both the things, similarities and dissimilarities, then there would be complete material before the judge to evaluate and to decide that particular issue. So coming to the testimony of the expert, the basic premises is the expert deposes and not decide, right? So what he has to depose regarding the facts, regarding the conclusion, regarding the scientific technology it is used by him, and his testimony would be covering two particular aspects. One, about the existence of the fact. Second, about the opinion. So that need to be there in the testimony of the expert. So basically the now testimony is normally oral, but even that should also be mentioned into the report, because if it is mentioned into the report, then in the court the expert can go and simply corroborate the same. But again, it would be subject to the cross-examination by the opposite party. Another thing is, in the eyes of law, before the court, expert is an ordinary witness. So now there are a number of judgments where the court has observed that the opinion of the expert is not a gospel truth. It has to be appreciated, it has to be evaluated, it is subject to the cross-examination like the testimony of the any other witness. The court will always consider it on the touchstone of probabilities and circumstances. So therefore, when expert is going to the court for the purpose of expert testimony or the deposition, he should be well prepared to give the answer to all the questions. He should be very well prepared that there should not be any doubt. And whatever he should say before the court will be full certainty. Because in criminal cases, it is only the benefit of doubt which is given. If the expert is not confident about what he's asserting before the court, the benefit may go to the accused. Even if the examination is the correct one, still court may not rely upon it. Now, biasness of the expert witness. So this is another reason, another question which has been raised in the various forensic report. So normally when a particular expert receives the exhibit, it comes along with the brief fact, it comes along with the what the thing which need to be proved. And particularly in case of the private examination, he's always a remunerated witness. He know very well in advance why it has been sent to him and what need to be proved. So in most of the cases, the court has also accepted there is an element of unconscious bias in the mind of an expert. Depending upon what content, what material has been sent to him. So basically, number of cases, even court has observed that while sending the material to him, the exact fact should not be sent to him in order to prevent the bias. Then coming to the liability. So now the electronic evidence has its own challenges. These forensic reports have its own challenges, and it will not be simply relied by the court. Court will particularly look into three factors. Number one, the validity of the underlying scientific principle. So that is your technology. So that is basically the Daubert principle. Second is the validity of the technique applying the principle. What technique is being used, whether it is being done by manually, whether it is being done by use of the forensic tool. Then if it is by the tool, then what is the authenticity of the tool? Because in programming, 2 plus 2 can be 22 and 2 plus 2 can be 4. And how that particular technique is being applied on a particular occasion. So that would refer to your SOP. So these three factors are the consideration for the court to decide about the validity of the opinion and to rely upon these particular opinion. Now coming to the relevancy of the second opinion, if the court is not satisfied, court can always send the content for the second opinion, and it again depend upon what are the issues which have been raised by the opposite party, from where the court could have made its mind that there may be an error or there may be some bias into that particular forensic report, and accordingly now the court can send it for the second opinion. So ultimately, if we look upon the holistic approach about the forensic report, first the court will look into the admissibility, second is the admissibility of technique, that is the Daubert principle. So then coming to the authenticity, the court will look into the credibility of the expert witness, quality of the opinion, SOP, production of the report on which the he is relying upon, then what the eyewitnesses says, because there would be other evidences which may support the forensic opinion, which may not support. So after evaluating the contradictory and corroborative opinion or corroborative evidence, the court will ultimately decide the reliability of that particular evidence. So these are some of the issues which an expert need to keep in mind while giving the testimony in the court of law. So Pratik, I'm making you the host. You can ask the question from the participant. I think now you can unmute all.
Yes, sir. I'll do that. One second.
Otherwise, what
you
can do?
So yeah, thank you so much, sir. So now, as we have come to the end of the session, we now open the floor for questions. If you have any questions, please select the option of raising your hand. So in that order, we'll accept questions.
Sir, can I ask?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. First, we'll have the question of Vijay, sir.
Good afternoon to all the panelists. And my question is to Mr. Neeraj Arora. He talked about the, remuneration bias of the expert witness. But does it not conflict with the fact that somebody has to pay the expert and the lab and the for all the tools which are being used to do the forensic analysis? Thank you.
I totally agree with you, but that thing is into the mind of the court. So basically, the expert need to keep in mind that if there is any lapse and if he is not able to corroborate, then drawing the conclusion of the biasness may be easy for the court. So that may be one of the relevant factors, and particularly that would be in cases of the private forensic. In case of the government forensic, experts are being paid by the government, and sometimes they are being paid by the different department. So in case of government, the problem is not much, but in case of the private expert, I have seen the number of cases where the court has not relied upon when they find some certain flaw into that particular report. So that could be one of the reasons which would be into the mind of the court. But if the expert is in a position to corroborate his opinion with the properly explaining the reason and connecting them with the final conclusion, then there is no issue to that.
Yeah, so Mr. Vijay, was your question answered, sir?
Yes, thank you.
Yes, sir. So now we'll move on to Anjali, ma'am. Ma'am, you can unmute yourself and you can ask the question.
Yeah, good afternoon, everyone. Yeah, my question is, who is liable to give the 64B certificate in the Evidence Act for the secondary source.
Hello.
Hello, sir. Am I audible?
Yes, you are audible.
Yes, sir. Good afternoon, sir. My question is, who is liable to give the certificate for the section 60B, 62B?
See, the certificate under 65B can be given only by the one person who is the owner or in charge of the computer device in which the evidence is stored. So that means the person who is a complainant, person who is a witness from whom the electronic evidence is seized, only he is competent to give the certificate. Forensic expert cannot give a certificate because the one of the requirements is that the this certificate contains a statement. And the statement is that the statement is that the electronic evidence had been generated when the evidence was in my control. And that statement cannot be given by the forensic expert.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Can I add something to this? Neeraj, please correct me if I'm wrong. To add on to what Neeraj said, I would just like to make it a bit simpler to Anjali, who has just asked. For example, there's an EFIR. And if a policeman, or I'm trying to understand a question at the lower level, someone is, if a EFIR is produced in the court, who can give a 65 fee for that particular document which has been printed out? The person, to my best of my knowledge or to wherever courts I have gone, the person who has generated that particular document, as rightly brought out, who is the owner of that machine, and he himself says, in to best of his knowledge, the system was working fine. And that reduced was the same result was produced what was in the system. So that is the person who can give the 65B. In case of, say, you can say companies and all, the system administrators who are there, who are working, they're in charge of the system, they know the know-how, they, according to me, they also can give the 65B. Regarding forensic experts, what I have experienced in the courts is, yes, rightly brought out by Neeraj sir, forensics cannot give 65B for the contents of that particular code. But when you're doing imaging, when you have done an image, and when you're stating that the image has been made by the forensic expert, in that cases, few cases, courts have asked for the 65B from that analyst who has carried out the imaging, stating that the system on which the image was carried out was working fine and same as for whatever there in the 65B. Correct me if I'm wrong, Neeraj.
See, now there is a new judgment of Bombay High Court where this issue was before the court. And the finding which have been given by the court is that if there is a original media which is before the court and its copy which is reviewed by an expert, then we don't require a certificate from expert. So I will share it with you.
Okay, thank you.
Exactly.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
Neeraj ji, with your permission, with regard to Form 65B, I think I'll add one more issue that recently came up. See, one of the things that normally happens, especially in economic crime kind of scenarios, is that as the Form 65B Act per se talks about, which all of us know, that is where the device or the evidence was originally identified, whether the device or the was in possession of the person who's giving the Form 65B, or is it belonging to a particular person or a particular organization as a whole, and whether there had been any user / original difference. Just for example, if we are taking an email example, the Form 65B is normally solicited from the service provider rather than just the user, because the email ID is just created by person A, but the contents of it is stored by the service provider in his servers. So the veracity of the data can actually be obtained only from the organization, which is a service provider hosting the email and securing it in their servers. So whether it was tampered or not cannot be verified by the user per se. But when it comes to the actual creation of the content, the user can give the Form 65B saying that I am in possession of this particular ID belongs to me and I have either received or I have sent this email. So would that be a right approach, Neeraj?
So first I want to clarify that there is a misconception, and some of the court and some of the people are not aware about Section 88A of the Evidence Act. Section 88A is specifically relating to the messages or the email. And this section says that when any message or email is sent, so then there is a presumption of correctness of the content. So that means we do not require any certificate from service provider. Certificate can be given by the person who is sending the message, but certificate can be given by the person who is receiving the message. So we don't require any certificate from the ISP. I hope that satisfies the answer to this question.
Yes, it does, definitely.
Thank you, sir.
Neeraj, sir, again, a question relating to the same issue which is now being discussed. If somebody has, attached, apart from email, some of the SMS messages and WhatsApp messages by taking the, WhatsApp web photographs or saving it on the as image files, who will give the 65B certificate in this case?
Like you take the example of the SMS. If I have received the SMS, I want to prove it is into my mobile, I can give the 65B for the SMS as well as the WhatsApp message.
Okay.
For both I can give. But one thing we always keep in mind, that we are talking, when we talk about Section 65, we are talking about all about the admissibility, not the authenticity. So authenticity may become one of the challenge, because the opposite party in the court may raise an issue that these are the manipulated one or these are the fabricated one. So then we always suggest you get it forensically examined and give it with a report. So that is the one way. Second is you submit the original mobile phone. Third is you submit the copy with 65B. But when there is a evidence, you should take the original mobile phone with you to show the court that original are still there in the mobile phone. So these are the three ways by which you can prove the authenticity.
Thank you.
Thank you. Welcome. Yes. Anyone else?
Yes, sir. So I had one question to both Murthy sir and Rajagopal Bharat sir. So so this is regarding the privacy of the individuals. So both of you did mention that, the Data Protection Act and how the privacy of the individuals is being given more important, like the personal information of the people. It's something like you stated, like how that's a gray area, that there are regulations coming up which restricts you from accessing particular data of the people. So now, this is something which has already been in force in countries countries in Europe and also USA. So because of this, wouldn't it make the job of forensic experts more difficult? Because there must have been cases where accessing their personal information would have been crucial for your case. So now, if that route is completely blocked for you, what would be the alternate methods or tools, new tools that you can adopt so that you are able to do this the work in the same efficient manner?
Okay, Mr. Murthy is there to answer this?
Yeah, I'm here. You want me to answer? You would like to answer, Mr. Bharat?
Yeah, you go ahead, Mr. Murthy. Then we'll continue if there is anything that is missing out.
Yeah. So, Pratik, if you remember in my slides, I did mention about intentional and unintentional access to information. It's not that it will be restricted, okay? And if it is accidental, okay. So, I'm doing a fraud case where my focus is more on some financial transaction. But accidentally, I access to a folder which contains some photographs of the accused person, some personal photographs of the person. So how many times I have accessed that photograph? will clearly shows the intention of the forensic examiner, number one. Number two, whether it was moved away from the seized exhibit, whether it was copied, all those things. It's not that forensics would become difficult in view of upcoming privacy frameworks. Only thing is, it will have a logging mechanism. It will have some checks and balances when it comes to access of personal information while dealing with any of the digital storage medias. So it doesn't restrict. It only tries to document it, the incidental, accidental, intentional, unintentional, all sort of access to personal information will be documented.
Can I add something to it?
Although see, just to add to Mr. Murthy.
Mr. Bharat, please.
Just to add to Mr. Murthy, see, actually what he says is absolutely true. See, in the current scenario now,
Bharat sir, I think you muted yourself by mistake. I think we lost Bharat sir. So till then, like Santosh sir, even you wanted to.
I just wanted to elaborate on what Mr. Murthy said, and you know there'll be a bigger problem. I'll just tell in form of a case which I did. I was doing a particular case related to X thing, means I was investigating something, some matter related to a X matter, which is maybe a financial fraud, I'm just saying. But when I was doing the analysis of that particular storage media, I found something very alarming. Alarming means the form of the personal photographs and videos. It was very alarming and it was of national security matter. So we flagged it to the particular IO investigating agency, whoever had sent that. And that turned out as a proactive measure of avoiding a very nasty incident. So I don't know how that this will cater for the when we say privacy and when we say GDPR will come and how it will affect the forensics. Because in forensics, when we see a forensics professional or forensic practitioner, by default, integrity, confidentiality in the lab also comes into picture. So even if he is privy to something, he is actually by the ethics is barred from actually revealing whatever he has seen or not seen. So we have, whenever this GDPR or something comes, this aspect has to be looked into, because then we cannot restrict or focus only on the aspect of a particular investigation when it comes to national security. So that's my point of view. I've been what I think needs deliberation.
Sorry, I think I got dropped out before Santosh started. See, there are a couple of things when we are looking at privacy aspects and the relation to forensics. One is, as I was earlier mentioning, the amount of data and exposure to personal information for a forensic professional is definitely much higher than a normal investigator, because you get to the bits and bytes of the devices which contains the personal information. So there is a lot more information that is available to you. But as Santosh has rightly said, as a forensic professional, you have to maintain your integrity and you have to have your line of control in terms of saying, where do I stop? Where do I look forward? See, if there is a case requires you to dwell deep into a personal information, you are at liberty to do so. But however, if the case does not require you to intervene into the personal lives of the individual, there is no reason that you should be looking into. Just like what Mr. Murthy had indicated, your tool should be in a position to log your intention in terms of number of times you have looked into the particular personalized information or personally identifiable information or a personal photographs or something that which really has sense, whether the material that is available in the device is relevant for the case. See, simple example, in many of the cases that I currently deal with, we end up getting a lot of these WhatsApp materials, and sometimes these also contain very personalized photographs which are being shared within the family groups. So fortunately or unfortunately, during the course of investigation, we are forced to have a cursory look into it. But at the same time, if there is no financial transaction or if there is no financial component related to the particular investigation, this set of chats need to be discarded. See, it is available to you in the forensic copy, but you have to take a decision what I should look and what I should not look. There is no point in saying it was there, I looked, then I made evidence out of it. That is not a proper way for a forensic person. The forensic person has to rightly decide whether is this digital material having evidence value for my particular case. If it doesn't have, then go behind. Don't go behind that data. Look for data which makes sense for you. Whereas in the example that Santosh has just mentioned, I think it makes sense for him to escalate it to the next level because it is an issue of national security. Even though it is a personal information, that which is not part of the case, if that information is going to facilitate you to find a bigger or rather avert a bigger threat, then obviously you are at a liability to escalate it so that a bigger problem is not created because of your ignorance or your innocence in not sharing the data. Have I answered your question, Pratik?
Yes, sir. Very well, sir. So thank you so much for answering the question, sir. Like Murthy, sir, Santosh, sir, and Bharat, sir. I just had another question to Murthy, sir, actually. So my question was, how exactly is the authenticity of a tool determined by the expert and also in the court? And also, suppose in the court of law, whether a tool expert without strong academic background would be competent to face the challenge in the court? Murthy, sir, are you there?
So Murthy is there.
I think he's facing some connectivity issues. We're also running out of time. So I'll just end the session over here. I'll just conclude it. So firstly, I would really thank all the speakers for taking out time from their busy schedules and enlightening us with their knowledge. Today's webinar was definitely full of practical knowledge and gave us deep insights into the various subtopics of leveraging computer forensic in litigation. And it also reveals some interesting facts. So Bharat sir first spoke about the role of computer forensics in litigation and gave the practical examples, which was very interesting. And Santosh Katsare sir spoke about the provenance of computer forensic report in courts. And we understood the ground realities of how the process functions. And Venkatesh Murthy sir spoke about the various tools that can be used in the forensic examination. And Neeraj Arora sir spoke about the various challenges and hurdles an expert witness faces with regard to his testimony. And sir also gave many real life examples and case laws to make it easier for us to understand. And I also thank everyone else involved in this event. And lastly, and most important point, we are also recording this webinar. And we will be uploading it to our YouTube channel. The name is Cyber Pandit. I'll also type it in the chat box. So you can always access this this webinar at a later date also. So it was really nice having all. We really expect to have more such fruitful webinars like today's webinar. And yeah, that's it from my end. I hope all of you have a beautiful weekend ahead. Thank you.